切れた話が欲しい。
Kapalı ya. Neydi?
Bir şey yok. Yani
video
artık. Görüntüden kapışıyor.
Dur bekleriz. Bekleriz. Genel çıkın bırak. Kablo var da bir sıkıntı çıktı şundan. Çözemedik. Şimdi geliyor. Ha, geliyor.
Ve kendisi VATP kurslarında eğitim ve sertifikasına göre eğitimdir. 2014 senesinden bu yana İzmir Yüksek Teknoloji Enerjisi Enerji
here that we have set up this department, so I actually will be sharing our vision with you. I'll not touch upon employment, only focusing on education. The thing is, since 2014 I've been in charge of this department. So, wind energy is actually an interdisciplinary branch. It is actually not something as we used to. It covers many things. Aerodynamic, for example, is the one of the top topics, and meteorology, because of the wind forecasts and for generation forecasts, you need that. And then there's a control system of the machine itself. It's important. And besides these three main things, there are also other topics. For example, construction is very important. I mean, it's something to do with the civil engineers, and it's also a subspecialty in a way. In economy in particular, just like in all branches of engineering, economy is also important, and economics is a bit different in ours, and therefore training as education is very important. First, our approach to the wind energy first. As for the education, before that I would like to say I just meet some people and they are willing to have postgraduate degree, master's or the PhD. They just consider this in a way just like a title that they consider, but education is not something that gives you a title. There's more than one way of education. Someone, for example, who worked in the field for many long years can go up to your level. But in formal education, in particular bachelor's, a degree, in master's degree, things could be a bit different. So anyone can prefer their own way. I mean, some people can go up to the PhD degree or after, for example, bachelor's degree. It's possible for you to get experience actually by working somewhere. So what do we have in general? And the people who are in the wind energy are coming from different disciplines. It could be mechanical engineering, aircraft, aviation, environmental, and physics, meteorology, civil, electrical, and materials engineering. So they can be a part of the wind energy industry. And therefore, there is nothing specific to wind energy, for example. There is the energy systems engineering department. It is possible for you to become an energy engineer, and for wind, that's also the case for the world. I mean, there's nothing specific to wind energy. We have 20 state public universities and 7 foundations that has a department on energy, and our average exam score is 400. After the bachelor's degree, of course, something else, something different starts. Why? Because for master's degree. And in Master of Science, it is actually an area that people can be educated directly. What do I mean? For example, you can have a postgraduate degree for mechanical engineering, environmental physics, meteorology, or aviation. You can have a Master of Science, and then you can work in the industry, and you can transfer it into the wind energy. But of course, it's just because of the direct need of the energy. We also have some departments of energy or wind energies. For example, we have a master's degree on energy, and under that, a master's degree on wind energy. What I mean is that if, for example, you'd like to write a thesis on wind energy specifically, you can take some classes and you can get a diploma from our university. And there are some other universities doing the same. But for the worldwide practices in Denmark, for example, I had 2 years of Master of Science in wind energy. It was a newly started program at that time in Denmark. And it's a full thesis, one. This is still an ongoing program, and there are so many students after me. It was 12 years ago. And I mean, that is actually one of the highest level of education. Of course, there are some things in, for example, the Netherlands, at Delft, and also in the United States. So it's the most aerodynamic and wind energy combined that they have. So after a certain period of time, the European Wind Energy Academy, 5 years ago, started an initiative. And today, there is a European Wind Energy Master's Degree Program, a very successful one. How it works, the students are joining that. I mean, I also know it from Broadland. For example, we pick up a team. For example, it could be offshore engineering, wind physics, or power systems, or rotor design. And then it is there that you spend your time at Tufeld, and then you just go to the next stop. I mean, once in every 6 months, a mobile system, like an exchange system. And it helps people to work at different fields, to learn different things, and to be a part of different scientific researches. And as they travel, for example, in one department, it's not possible to find trainers on all topics, on all disciplines. But thanks to that circulation, it is possible for you to go and find the best expert in the field. And then you can go to Norway, for example, for offshore engineering. And at last, by the end of year two, you pick up a thesis topic. It could be actually, it should be one of the relevant to the places you've been to. You went there back, and you just have your, again, master's degree program. And in the European wind energy. It's very successful for Europe, and it's really functioning well properly. And as you would see here, the growth rate is pretty high in wind energy, and Majority of this is from Europe, and they're also open to other markets as well. So every year, they're in need of new engineers. And if you would remember, people coming from the bachelor's degree, for example, are experienced on one thing, construction, aerodynamics, environment. But wind energy is multidisciplinary. Therefore, these programs are picking the people, they fill in the gaps, and in the field of wind energy, they actually turn into some very talented ones. So it's these three things I'd like to show you. Of course, there are some other cases in the world, but these three are very important. After the master's degree, what happens? PhD. The PhD is just one only in Turkey, as you all know. It is again a formal, an informal education institution. You will be taking your classes, and after they're over, you have to pass the competency test, and then you can start writing your thesis. And in 1 year or on 3 years' time, you can have your PhD degree and title. That's in general how it is applicable in Turkish universities. But in the world, it is a bit different. There's an academic PhD, which I'm speaking about now. And it's 100% again formal education with thesis. But there's also the term industrial PhD concept in the world. For example, you have an education on PhD, on wind energy as a master's degree. You're working in a company. But there is an R&D career that you're planning on that specific company. You want to be an R&D engineer on a very specific topic you would like to work on. And then the methods in Europe is the industrial PhD. And those who are willing to have an R&D career, 30% formal education, I mean, you have to go to the university to take some classes, like once a week, I guess, one day a week, and then 70% on-site education at the workplace. Of course, your superior, for example, supervisor should have a PhD degree or should be working in the field for a certain period of time. And if you meet certain criteria, then it's possible to have a PhD study with thesis. I think it's important for our country. Why? Because for the time being, we have so many PhD students and they prefer to work at the same time. If, for example, we have such a system, industrial PhD also in Turkey, I'm sure so many people will apply for this. And in particular, that's a field that we would like to develop on R&D. Therefore, I believe industrial PhD is going to be important. But on PhD, I have a personal opinion. I don't know, maybe my colleagues will not agree, but it is either academic or R&D career. There's no point in making any PhD. I mean, as you would appreciate, you can possibly go and work in a company that you can have huge experience, but it's my personal opinion, as I told you. So that is actually for postgraduate degree. 5 minutes left, okay. I'll try to be quick. Technical education is another part of it. For example, with regards to measurement technicians, and that's what I know, because especially on these measurement poles or about how to perform it, we should know about this. I don't think we're doing fine with this. In terms of construction technicians, that's good. I think it's because we are just quite experienced in construction. And again, operation and maintenance technician is important. It was, for example, 10 years ago that we were just asking them to come from Turkey. And I'm sure that things would be much better. And the other thing is continuous education. And of course, after we succeed in doing so, after start working in the industry, it's important to get short-term courses. Why? Because there's actually a new technology coming up, and you can take some short-term courses for that. For example, the academy has some classes. Again, WindPro again has some software courses, Energy and Climate Academy from Denmark, the NDGL, DTU, our university has some short-term courses, also some tech university has some courses. Same, I mean, there are such programs by different universities.
Bir parçası olmaya başladı Avrupa'da.
Distant education is a part of continuous education in Europe, but that's not the case yet for Turkey. But it will be possible also to get distant education. Another point is about the in-service training. I don't know how it is in Turkey because I'm not working for any private sector company in Turkey. Through the end, in the energy education plan, in the world that is mostly PhD-concentrated R&D engineers, and also basic sciences education for wind energy, and mostly focusing on PhDs, quite clear-cut, physics, mathematics, and chemical engineering that they would like to invest on rather than mechanical engineering. Why? Because they have reached to a certain level, and from basic sciences level they would like to do this, and they also have certificate programs for technical expertise and also continuous education. In Turkey, we need to strengthen interdisciplinary approach, and we have the need to focus on R&D experts, focusing on postgraduate, and we need technical expertise and also continuous education. So there are certain objectives. And rather than at once training, better to have a continuous education model. I mean, I think it's important that people actually should follow 3-day, 5-day courses, and they actually have to refresh their knowledge all the time. And the wind energy classes, basic wind energy classes at the university should be made a part of the continuous education. In our university, it's possible for the people in the industry to join our classes, and so free of charge, you just apply for it. And the other thing is actually to have competent engineers in the industry with some postgraduate degrees. For example, an environmental engineer, a civil engineer, they actually have a basic knowledge, but we have some basic problems. I mean, for example, for the integration of the new engineers, it would be nice to have some postgraduate programs. Also, there's a need to have the legislative change for industrial PhD, and also the PhD education should be brought up to the level of patent. I mean, it also should be supported by domestic production. And for technician training, there's a need to have some high schools for wind energy, and maybe 2 to 3 month technician training courses and certificate programs can be started. Thank you. Quite well prepared presentation. Thank you very much. We have engineering faculties, as you all know. Also, I mean, engineering departments under regular universities and also technical universities, but we also now have technology universities like İzmir, Gebze. These are technology universities. Therefore, besides Department of Engineering, the technical vocational high schools now turn into technical faculties, and we have 2-year and 4-year, again, college degrees as well. There are some sub-specialties, sub-expertise programs, like conditioning, for example, could be one thing. But looking at all, both the basic engineers and the hybrid engineers, but we have 27 energy systems department, engineering department, right? And I think it was at Yalova University I established that. Also, energy systems specialist degree. These are the hybrid programs, as you all know. And the students are getting prepared for the industry. I mean, once they start, for example, start the employment, they can better prepared. So these are the, but as the professor stated, in the world, we are really envy of them, mainly for wind, for example, Denmark is number one country, and in, for example, one university, there's an energy technology program, a perfect program. The third and fourth year students are working actually on energy projects in the industry, but for the white collars, we're just doing much better. But in terms of the blue collars, we blue collar ones, we are in need a lot. A group of high school students starts to work at Kocaeli, and in terms of establishing a technical high school. But things are changing, of course, so we don't have the approval yet. Maybe in the past, the technicians were trained elsewhere. But now we have the wind power plants and the renewables, of course, it's a deficit. And just like in the German discipline, again, there are some apprentice schools, which also would be useful, I guess. Now we'll move to the second speaker. From Amasya University, Faculty of Technology, Deputy Dean, Esin Prof. Ünal Kurt. He was born in Amasya at Marmara University, Technical Education Faculty at Department of Electricity. He graduated, then at Gazi University, he completed his postgraduate degree. His PhD at 19 Mayıs University, and still he is at Amasya University working as a faculty member. And he is again the chair of the Department for Renewable Energy. Married with three children. Floor is yours. Thank you. Distinguished guests, welcome, and thanks for preferring this hall. I would like to thank to Ferhat because he really provided a lot of data, so I'll skip some of my slides. For Amasya University, we have 6 faculties, 9 colleges and vocational high schools, and 2 institutes. We have 17,000 students. It is actually a small-scale university in a, at the, I can say, a small town. And with regards to renewable energy, for the, almost for 2 years, we have a multidisciplinary renewable energy and practices department. And from different disciplines, students are coming who are really willing to be a part of renewable energy, from chemistry, from physics, mechanical engineering, biology, industrial engineering, even, for example, business administration. Majority of those are having their thesis now. Ferhat mentioned about how the PhD studies are, and I would like to tell you how we do it at the laboratory, on the field, at the campus area. In particular, there are certain projects of our university. At Amasya University, I will also show you a video. I coordinate 2 projects. One of them by the Central Black Sea Development Agency has offered us some grant, 200 kilowatts of a distant remote on-grid roof solar system. Again, we're academicians, so that actually was an investment incentive project, but we somehow included it into education. And in this, we also have a meteorological stations that can process data, and 3 off-grid 3.2 kilowatts of, again, wind turbines, and 3 of them off-grid, and 2 at Marzipan Vocational High School, and the 3rd one at the campus of the Technology Faculty. On the top of this, at the campus area, we have an off-grid system, and we also added solar panels, so a hybrid system. And again, off-grid system again for solar power as well. So both the students of the bachelor's degree at Electrical Engineering and our students, postgraduate students, are using it. It is 967,000 Turkish liras and 75% of those covered by the Development Agency of the Central Black Sea. Of course, in doing so, both academically and institutionally, we learned a lot. A grant project, and as you know, in grant projects, you have to complete them at a certain time. It's not possible to receive the grant. So we had the procurement, and also I actually a lot of time I came to Ankara, the bureaucracy for the Turkish electricity generation company. And once you have the private sector company, if they cannot complete it on time, you are just deprived of the, of course, the grant. I think actually I can tell you that I've experienced myself all the things to be discussed in these 2 days, all the bureaucratic obstacles and everything, even at the level of the president of the university. Experience. This has been 1 year, and for almost 1 year, we are just connected to the electricity distribution company, and our invoices are issued. And depending on the sum, we are either paying out of pocket or receive some money. We have a video now. Also, the press and media coverage will also be seen. Of course, this project, I mean, this is totally outsourced, but we've been a part of this totally. I'm sure the experts would know. We also have train the trainers concept. We actually had the chance to test everything. You would see some shadows. For this, if we were just doing it once again, there will be no shadow areas like this if we were supposed to do it from the scratch. That's the roof of our faculty building, and there is energy generation now. So also at the Faculty of Technology, we have the on-grid and off-grid. Again, only wind, only solar. We also have an open-air lab.
Ajansıyla ortak proje gerçekleştirdi. Üretirken öğreniyoruz projesi kapsamında elektrik ve elektronik mühendisliği bölümü öğrencileri yenilenebilir enerjinin uygulamalı eğitimini alıyorlar.
Teknoloji fakültesindeki öğrencilerimizle birlikte Üretirken Öğreniyoruz isminde bir proje geliştirerek Ortak Karadeniz Kalkınma Ajansı'ndan destek aldık. Bu projedeki amacımız geleceğin mühendislerine enerji farkındalığını oluşturmak, daha çok derslerimizi sahada birebir yapabilmek için bu tür tesisleri geliştirmeye çalıştık.
Proje kapsamında güneş, meteoroloji istasyonu ve bunların uzaktan izlemesi için açık uygulamalı bir laboratuvar oluşturuldu. Oluşturulan sahada öğrenciler teorik eğitimin yanında pratik olarak çalışma imkanı buluyor.
Hem rüzgar, hem güneş, hem meteoroloji istasyonumuz ve bunların uzaktan izlemesi olduğu için açık uygulamalı bir laboratuvar olarak kullanacağız biz burayı.
Projenin bize katkılarından en önemlisi teoride değil, yani kağıt üzerinde değil de direkt uygulamada, sistem üzerinde görebiliyoruz.
Proje sayesinde biz öğrencilerimizle birlikte pratik olarak saha içerisinde direkt çalışma imkanı sağlanmış oldu.
Amasya'nın evet. Merzifon ilçesinde ilkokul
öğrencisi. Şimdi gördüğünüz gibi arkadaş.
So as you can see, that's the development agency project, and it was a reference to us. And we have also received an EU-funded project. And now it is month 8 that we've completed, and it's about to be completed. And again, in the field of renewable energy, again, there also will be some short-term courses, as the previous speaker stated. And for these students, again, around Amasya region. It's a nice region for renewable energy where so many WPPs and 40 megawatt WPPs, and they had the chance to work there and also had internship. And of course, we also applied to the Supreme Education Board, and so we opened our postgraduate study. That was from the first project. And that's the EU project that I told you. Again, in our own technology faculty, we have established these laboratories. Anything about renewable energy can be tested in here, in these laboratories. Here you can see majority of those will be focused, next slides will be focusing on the different institutions that provide master's degree, PhD in Turkey. No need to provide statistical data, but it is not only in electrical engineering, wind or solar specific, but now there is a multidisciplinary approach. I mean, energy is a multidisciplinary field, therefore, especially only renewable energy or energy systems or, for example, wind, specifically wind, I mean. So it's possible that anything can be used in energy. I mean, we're just trying to raise people. Even tourism on its own, for example, is today is an area that renewable energy can offer something, because as you would appreciate, there are several technical visits and social things. They have a major market share. It is possible, for example, to have the tourism while the holy places are visited. It's the same. It's possible that the WPPs can, I mean, those graduates in the tourism area can also be employed. So, 8 foundation universities and 15 state universities that we have, Energy Systems Engineering Department of Bachelor's Degree in 23 universities. And again, in 1,000 state universities, I mean, 1,000 of those graduates from state universities, 1,300 on the annual basis from the other universities, but still there's things for intermediary technical personnel. And it is not only possible to actually educate engineers. We need certificate programs, short-term courses, and again, they are all important. And it's important to have a multidisciplinary approach, especially those graduates from vocational high schools, I guess, should be properly considered. Similarly, in Turkey, looking at the wind energy projection worldwide, you probably know about this. There's no need to actually focus on this, but there's one too. The renewable energy is actually an emerging value, and it's possible to reach to huge capacities, and it also will lead to an important employment opportunity. Therefore, some of the, for example, departments of are closed down, like physics, science, and so, because it is, there's no point in now if you do not provide any opportunity for employment. This is developing and emerging field, and maybe basic sciences, of course, not possible to close down such faculties, but people cannot find jobs after graduation. So renewable energy systems, there's no problem with that. The only thing is that diploma, of course, is required, but not adequate. What is important is actually to give them the necessary competency and skills. So that's the reason why we establish such laboratories. I've also skipped those.
Yeah.
What are the expectations from the employees of renewable energy? There's the need to have some occupation-related competencies, again, industry-specific ones, personal factors, academic competencies, they're all important. And of course, what is important is actually management competencies as well. So it's quite a wide spectrum, as you can see. I mean, with one single academic program, with one single curriculum, not possible to do anything about this, but not theoretically, but in practice, we should be able to do something about it. So, in conclusion, what we can say, I believe the class contents academically should be identified with the all the stakeholders. As the deputy dean, I also would like to thank to in particular the Turkish Wind Energy Association. I'd like to thank the president in particular. Why? They also were one of the partners of the CU project. They supported us a lot. We have Renewable Energy Club as well. And also at the Black Sea, we have a wind event. And also at Genamasi, we have a panel on wind. And therefore, while we get prepared for renewable energy, it's important to be always in close contact with the stakeholders. And all the classes must be practical as well. There's a need to focus on subspecialties, so wide area, not possible to know about everything. And international certification is important, like occupational safety. And foreign language is a must, no point to discuss it. And at the same time, we have to tell people that there's no concept of business hours. I mean, for example, I'm always telling my students, for example, I'm telling you about electrical machinery, but there are videos on the YouTube that better tells you can learn a lot from there. But if I teach you, there should be no excuses. I mean, and for example, you limit yourself to working hours, then there's nothing you can do about it because there are no excuses and no, again, concept of overtime. Again, internship is important, on-the-job training is important, and the other thing is train the trainers. It's very important, and I think we also should be working on this, I guess. If you're interested, Amasya University, also we have the representative of Vestas here. And there is also, it would be nice to have our university to be a center. I mean, all our resources are at your disposal, and we are ready for any form of cooperation. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much for your approach. Of course, in the universities, we also have the technoparks. And there's also a new concept now, as you all know, the technology transfer office is a new concept, and they also should take a role in this also. We have the organized industrial zones in the cities, and the universities are working in cooperation with such industrial entities, which is important. And with regards to energy systems, I think they are also set up as society. And we also have the president of the Energy Systems Society. You see our young colleague. I don't know how in the market almost 1,000 energy systems engineers working in the market. And some of them really find some good jobs. And it is between 2008 and 2009 that study started, so as you can see, which is good, we have actually a trained, competent graduate. Now, next speaker. The speaker is from Southern Marmara Region Development Agency, Osman Erol İnce. From Celal Bayar University, Department of Finance. And he had his engineer also
Business Management PhD and started to work at Marmara Municipalities Union. And then now he's working at the Development Agency for the South Marmara region. Since 2014 he's been working there. In the field of renewable energy and education, he is also running an EU project, 10 million euros of project application accepted, and five different regional, again, researchers with several conferences, and there are also financial support programs that he did, and he can speak English, married with one child, and of course, thank you very much at the same time. Hello everyone. Let's start where I'm coming from. I'm coming from here. That is, in terms of wind, the best region in Turkey and how it is reflected in the field. That's where I'm coming from. And also here. That is the map of 2014. We have a newer version, but not much has changed. Our region is still responsible for 25% of the energy generated. So Turkey is leader and it probably will continue for some time more. And as a development agency, it gives us a lot of responsibility with regards to renewable energy, what type of strategies should be developed. Especially, it's actually very important for us to focus on more and more on that. Why? Because the wind energy can go up to 5,400 megawatts under the targets, but for machinery and equipment manufacturing, to what extent we can do it, it was a question mark. At the same time, for the industry, it started to be a question mark, which is something good for the industry. In terms of training the personnel, R&D, maintenance and repair services that I'll focus on, engineering and consulting services, logistics operations, construction services. For example, as Balıkesir, Çanakkale, or as Turkey, what percentage we could offer? Also as Turkey, not only as a region. As you all know, we would like to actually bring it one step further. So two main things that we have. One, to have local manufacturing, manufacturing, and in doing so, people who are working at the turbines, at the wind turbines, and those at different parts, to be from the region. Our role in here is to be a facilitator. And again, the energy of youth meets the energy of wind. We write such a project, 353,000 euros budget of the project, and duration 12 months. And the Minister of Labor, again, provided us with some support. Here you can see the project team, five faculty members. And I'm also talking on their behalf. I'll skip those. So, how we execute the project, why we did it, and what our plans for the future are. First of all, it's important to have an objective selection system. Electrical and electronic engineering, industrial engineering, and mechanical engineering. 30 students from there, and 40 from electrical, electronic technology, consulting automation technology, and electrical communication technology from the vocational colleges. We received 117 applications and 64 from engineering faculties and 53 from vocational colleges. First, for all the students. I mean, before we start the program, we planned a 3-month curriculum. And we just came together with the representatives of the industry. Why? Because there must be something correspondent. I mean, it's very important to train such individuals that they can find jobs in the market. And to do so, before the start of the program and before we design the curriculum,
we actually talked to so many stakeholders in the industry. We also, Enerji staff and Polat Enerji, they were also the participants and partners to the project. So first, about working at height, we received such, again, certificates for the students. So that's 5 for 5 days and 40 hours of working at height, first aid, about fire extinguishing, manual handling. We have the students receive such a training, so the companies will not pay for additional education and training for the new recruits, so it will be an advantage for them to pick the job. And therefore, it is such a center that provides such certification. And then engineering, again, authorization education is important, and together with the Electric Engineers Chamber, at the high voltage plant, we provide the training and also installation education for wind energy and engineering for work safety engineering training, and we just finished it in the recently. With the Mechanical Engineers Chamber, for the mechanical engineers, we received two separate training. One about the investment services, because as you all know, especially industrial engineers are more on the table side, on the desktop side, they're more dealing with the planning. So we provided training for them, and then strategic planning course that we have. And then for the mechanical engineers, again, the course on being a worksite supervisor. We plan it for the mechanical engineers, but also for the industrial engineers. And then composite manufacturing and repair training. Again, a 5-day, quite a comprehensive training that we provide. Therefore, also, when they apply for a job, in a company, they can actually work in a company that's dealing with localization. Also for the technicians, we have a high voltage installation, and that's a certificate that allows them to work at high voltage installations. Again, at SOMA, they receive training, a successful one, and all the trainees successfully passed the training. And then for our own curriculum, it was 453 pages that we had a curriculum book. It is actually not made public yet, because the first training started in October and it's ongoing. However, not yet, because it is handed over to the students. Together with the feedback, we'll finalize the book. Because, as you all know, short-term training is very important. Besides short-term training also, it is important to have some certificate programs that can well be reflected to the business life. So we just want it to be a good training program, so everything must be finalized, and then we'll publish the material, the training materials, the basic automation training, and panel preparation, and upline program, project reading, lab practices. So that's the center, the training center. By the way, our university also provided us with a lot of support, 5,000 square meter closed area allocated to us, only for energy training. It was previously used for another purpose, and they allocated this to us. But this project is just something like an inception, a small step taken. And therefore, right after this project, there's a 4.6 million euros of a renewable energy training program. And this training program awarded the first winner in Turkey. And therefore, with the best practices, best techniques in the world, in Europe, we're just planning to transform it into Balıkesir and Çanakkale region. What's for sure is that in some small universities, I mean, universities other than the three major cities in Turkey, as you all know, they start everything a bit late. I mean, one step back, I mean, they have to work harder for acceptability and for reliability purposes. And but of course, I think it's important that people can become specialists. I mean, energy, wind, and the sector-specific components. If everything is together, it's okay, because as you all know, so that's the main goal. That's what we're all working for. And therefore, it will turn into a center. And of course, the universities are pretty well responding to that. Okay, to move on, electrical installations, WPP, basic education, and these are just some pictures taken from the lab. Again, WPP, generation, installation, maintenance, training, site selection, SolidWorks, AutoCAD, project management. Again, WPP education according to the legislation. Technical English is, for example, from Denmark, from Germany, or from anywhere. It would be nice, for example, to find out what they are doing and to apply it on the field. I mean, to get the information and try to solve the problem on the field. And if there is any problem, for example, they can further ask for it. So at a level that they can contact with abroad. So there's an ongoing, again, basic English education and WPP terminology. So these are some of the materials for the lab. What comes next? Of course, entrepreneurship training that we'll provide. And after entrepreneurship training, either Balıkesir or at Çanakkale University, there is the technology development areas, and there will be free of charge site allocation, and we'll give them some incentives to start their own business. And at the same time, we expect some support from you, that is to say internship and employment opportunities. For internship, we're already talking to several different organizations, and some of them provided us with some approval for that. And especially about the insurance premiums, during internship will be paid by us, and 10 euros of pocket money that we pay. What we ask from you is, we try our best to raise the best personnel. That's a good program. What we wish from your side is that you accept them to become interns in your own institutions, and if possible, to be employed later. It's important for sustainability of the program, and at the same time for reproducibility of the program as well. So, in terms of internship and employment opportunities especially, you're all kindly invited to do so, and we are ready for any negotiation with you. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you. You have actually prepared an education module, I would say. I mean, it is like we can take it and apply it anywhere, right? Thank you very much. You know, if there are students and faculty members who are willing to work in Turkish universities, and I think let's not call it as the major universities, and so, of course, I'm at the faculty member for the oldest university ever in Turkey, but there are such universities and such departments that in Anatolia, and like Erciyes University, for example, basic sciences, they really work so hard there. We know it pretty well. I just wanted to share it. Maybe let's say universities of big cities and smaller cities, much better terminology to use. And of course, it is either technical education and all master's degree, PhD that we're speaking about, but especially in our social culture, there's also energy literacy as well. Why? Because once you wake up, you start to consume energy. And together with energy consumption, without any professional selection, it's important to know what is where. I mean, the young people should know where the opportunities are. Education is very important. It is something that down to the primary school that it's important to select for the career path. Now we have a very experienced human resources manager with us. Bestas Turkey, human resources manager, Meltem Daçı, Department of Economics, Middle East University, Çukurova University, and completed postgraduate degree. And then at Sabancı Holding, at Gdansa, at Klinsa, at cement industry, at different parts. And she was involved in some HR, management processes. And at Bestas, again, the manager of human resources 2 days ago at the national press, there was a news, we wish for the global investment to come to Turkey, so Vestas will actually increase their investments in Turkey, which is very pleasing to us. Thank you. It will be a short presentation, but I would love to actually see your card. Of course, after coming from different industries, I think energy is very lucky, because young people, especially for career development, we don't actually have too many industries where there is so high cooperation. All these things, the speakers that I've listened to, quite nice for the companies, for the recruits. These are good opportunities. I'm just representing the private sector or the employer, I can say. And at the side of training and employment opportunities, what we have. Maybe we can provide more detail later. Very briefly, Vestas. Vestas is actually one single word I can define, the only global wind energy company. I mean, Vestas is actually the only field of interest is wind. And from there, again, was an ID card of a company from the vision, mission. As you can see, Vestas, the vision of Vestas is to be the undisputed global wind leader, and the strategic objective, completing the vision, is actually focusing on growth. And we have 3 main values, also shared by all the employees. Also cooperation, responsibility, and also simplicity. So that's the foundation that Vestas has built upon. I mean, once you start working at Vestas, we'll be focusing on those. And again, about Vestas, what is important is to speak about safety. Safety should start from the gate, and again, it's a must for Vestas. Also, in the world, you can actually follow the developments there. And again, over 1 million hours of work time, 1.5 of injuries per 1 million working hours, lost time. And that's also one of the priority topics in Turkey. World Vestas, and it's actually a global market leader, as we define, and almost 35 years of experience. I mean, for wind turbine manufacturing, 35 years, and it's acting in 6 different continents and in 75 almost countries. And in the world, around 22,000 employees worldwide. In service contracts, 33,000, 76 gigawatt installed capacity. And again, 100% dedication to wind only. And for Vestas and Turkey, what we do very briefly. In Turkey, in terms of sales of turbines, project design, and the service delivery, and plus with regards blade, again, manufacturing, we've just started,
and 165 employees that we now have. But since 2008, again in parallel to the growth in megawatts, I mean, we started with 30 as the employee, and it actually is increasing year by year. Mostly it is the technicians on site that majority of the employees. Again, we have university graduates and again vocational high school graduates who are working on the service sites. And we have a team of 110 as the technicians and 559 turbines so far, total 1,500 megawatts, and we provide service on 30 sites. Again, on the map, you can see on which service sites we offer our service. It is Marmara, again, Akdeniz area. Now, the main topic. Of course, whether there is any growth in the market or not, that's important. Where employment can go. In the previous session, all the discussed some figures in the world, in Europe, this figure, that figure. In Turkey, again, for 2023, some growth targets. We always have them. Also, in the past years, again, last year, for example, 5% in the renewable sector. And then inside that growth, wind energy itself is important. And today in the world about wind turbine technician, it's actually a job or professional that people are seeking for. And of course, what we can do in Turkey, what we can propose for Turkey. For Turkey, if 1 gigawatt of a growth that we plan for Turkey, then if each megawatt is 3 or 4 people, then it will make 3 or 4,000 employees that we will be in need of. For now, in our operations, it's mostly the service that we focus on. But especially so as to increase the employment, what we can do. Maybe the most important thing is to have sustainability. When we mean sustainability in employment, that's most localization of the suppliers chain. And maybe just like the case in the other countries, the most important thing is actually to have a market which is sustainable. And in doing so, what we can do is to have a strategy. I don't know, maybe some of the things should be identified much better. I think the private sector should also be motivated and brave from this perspective. Besides, again, there are certain practices. Maybe we should not be retrospectively. Again, what I mean is that it's very easy to lose what you have just gained, like Spain, for example. In a very short period of time, almost a 20,000 reduction in the huge wind industry and that, again, capacity. Again, what we're doing at Vestas in our recruitment, it's important to say that it's an attractive sector for sure. I mean, there are several people, just so as to be green collar, they show an interest on this. In recruitment, again, for everyone in the field, it's important for them to show an interest. And if in terms of continuing all, I mean, as the professor stated, there's actually no overtime. Of course, all jobs are challenging. Each and every industry has its own problems. But there are so many unknowns. Sometimes you cannot fully forecast about the wind or about meteorology, some of the uncontrolled things that you have. So that devotion is important, that dedication for the employees. What else we look for? We're a global company, right? Therefore, foreign language skills is important to us. And as you mentioned, technical English, for example.
is important in particular. Even, for example, something at the background is important for the technicians and everyone, for the office employers, use again. Flexibility, as I told you, is important because there are challenges brought by the job itself, so there's the need and the willingness to be flexible, which is important. Well, these are the main things, of course, in recruitment, and both the white collars, I mean, and the technicians, the blue collars, for them, that's all I can say, I mean, for them, for the time being, as Vestas. Especially we understand it from our populations, most of the technician position that we're just looking for. And we're okay with that, but in the upcoming period, what we know is that technicians are always required in all industries. I mean, also people who are coming there in education should be brought in here, especially the people who are clear in their minds would be good for us. And therefore, university-private sector cooperation is going to be of high importance. At the training side, Vestas, for its own employees, I would say, offers worldwide standard opportunities. I mean, for example, especially for the newly recruits, even if they receive some education before, they have to be subject to a certain level of training. For example, a technician who just started the job, they actually have to spend the first 24 days of the first month with training and service training, and then another 22 days with another group of technicians. Therefore, the education side, both in the country and outside the country, they are actually all shaped and designed accordingly. So it takes some time. And as I told you, this is actually something repeated all the time. As you would appreciate, safety at work is important, technical training is important. And as for the office employees, of course, both at personal development and technical training, there are several different options, both in terms of distant education and domestic training and foreign training. Especially, it's not only for Vestas employees, but also for our customers and for the employees of our customers, and also for their subcontractors. About career and Vestas, what can I say? As a technician, once you started working at Vestas, you can be a leader, technician, supervisor, up to becoming a manager. I mean, you can have a career path while working for Vestas. At the white collar side, again, depending on their own preference, they can follow three paths. One, for example, process management side, or it is know-how and innovation that you would like to continue with your career, or the project management side. So it's possible that you can actually have different options. That's what we also plan. So in general, these are the main topics that I can go through. And if you have some questions, I can reply them later. Thank you. Thank you, Meltem. Cement is also very energy intensive with some high carbon print. So we succeeded in taking you back to become a green collar. Of course, in your career, you at the same time can become a green collar, but of course, someone who is dealing with renewable energy, it doesn't matter whether you are a blue or a white collar, but you always have another idea, the green color. Now, if you allow me, I would like to ask you if you have some questions. Then I will ask them for the final words. Introduce yourself and ask your question. Yes, please. One question, please. Speak to the microphone.
Güney
For example, I went to Sinop. There's so much wind. But there's also no wind in the east. Is it because we have the HPP, no need for wind? Or is it because of difficulty in investments that we don't have? My question is to our colleague from Amasya. At Amasya, we actually had a conference on wind, and the president of the association had a joke. The Black Sea people would not like to make money out of air. All the investors who would like to make use of wind, there's no concern. Sinop, I also visited there a lot. Maybe you have such an observation that there's so much wind, but it's not feasible. I mean, the wind potential in Marmara region, the capacity is actually better. It's not feasible in Sinop. I mean, if there's such a huge potential, the investors would already go there. So that's all about efficient wind capacity. But of course, the website of the Renewable Energy Directorate General, just there is a wind energy atlas there. I mean, it doesn't mean that to what extent the wind is powerful, the height is important, all others. Once Turks came to Anatolia, they have already made a feasibility study on windy locations, and they've named the places after wind, our blowing wind. Maybe for Black Sea, over the wind, PPs will be meaningful, but as you would appreciate, it is mostly the locations with some higher opportunity that the entrepreneurs are investing on. Also, we have now the new term, YECA, that is the renewable energy source fields, and also the state is trying to take this under control. So I'm sure that there will be some new projects to come up. I mean, having a wind somewhere doesn't mean that there will be wind. I mean, at least for 1 year, there's the need to do something about it. Thank you. My question is to Meltem. You stated that it's most of the technicians that you are looking for, or the blue colors that you recruit mainly. What do you do for the white colors? I mean, does Vestas, for example, has a training for that? Thank you. I mean, it's most of the technicians, but because for Turkey, I can say, also it is something to do with the previous programs as well. For recurrent, of course, both the blue colors and the white colors that we recurrent already for different positions. And you would also know it from our, again, the announcements for job opportunities. Actually, we're so lucky, I would say, because there are so many young people who are either no experience at all or some few experiences. It's possible to work with them. And again, the training programs that we offer also for the white collars. We offer training both in Turkey and abroad. Vestas Global at the same time identified the training programs and they can join them. And that's the reason why we have different programs in Turkey. I don't know what you exactly need as an information, but that's all I can say. I mean, I'm not saying that blue colors are sold more than white colors, but especially the programs for the white colors are much more defined. Because they are very important for the performance of the work.
Yani ben biraz bir cümle olacak ama önümüzdeki dönemde
Probably in the upcoming period, Vestas is considering Turkey as an important market. Why? Because as for the region that we are in, as you all know, for example, Turkey is a single region on its own, other than several countries to be one specific region. Maybe that's an indication of the interest in Turkey. But about what might happen in the long run, sustainability, predictability, and also reliability of the market, I guess there is a need to wait for the market to become more mature, because it is not at the generation side or manufacturing side, it's mostly sales, project design, and the service that we provide. Finance, purchasing, also in some others we continue with recruitment. I mean, engineering, yes, it's okay, and we also talk to the engineers there and we work together with them. But on the production side, of course, it could be a bit different, I can say. Thank you. Any further question? Then before I conclude, I'd like to ask some questions to the speakers and to ask them to have their final words. For Osman Ince, I'm wondering whether in the field of energy and renewables, will there be new calls for projects and proposals at the development agencies? With regards to renewables, the first call, we did it as the Southern Marmara Development Agency. And we are just providing support to establishment and installation of renewable energy systems. But we are the agency that comes to the idea first that that's not an efficient method. There are 26 development agencies in Turkey in 26 regions, and almost all of them are making calls for renewables. But I think the essence is actually to increase localization and local resources and to actually have added value within the value chain. And once we did this, I think it is mostly machinery and the production and all the others. And for the last 2 years, that's how we're doing. And all I can tell you is that it's not only environment and renewables. It could be, for example, a project only specific for that. I think that's how it will continue due to the specificity of the region. And I think also the other agencies will continue to provide support, because that's one of the most important for our country. I mean, especially for developing localization, I guess it is more. I think it's something good for our energy strategy. Now, enough, Kurt. Now, you're also an administrator, and you're also doing something in practice. And of course, we are the faculty members at the state universities. What kind of a technical education and training would be? I mean, because as you all know, you are just a department doing the best within the existing system. I think what is important in here is, up to now, up to recently, I mean, the state universities, the institutes and all, for example, they are saying it's actually a faculty working just like a plant, a running facility. It is important, I guess. The university and the private sector should cooperate with each other all the time. And while we coordinate for these types of activities, we went to the private sector and we were so proud. We, for example, had the automotives department, and by developing the labs there, it will be possible to have, for example, the inspection of the car. I mean, the first quality inspection check to save time. And then we just offered it to the industrials as a success, and they offered us some tea. And then someone said to a colleague, it is now the time, actually, to just finish the business, to close down the business. The universities will start doing business. Actually, I think
It is important that also the private sector should do something about it. And because there is a need for good experience, there are some fields that require innovation. Therefore, we have to be jointly working with them. And there are some good mechanisms for this. I don't know if you would agree with me, but once I first started working as an academician, people told me, if we have a good decision-making process, we would make great projects. And if we have the money, then we can make great projects. But I'm really very ambitious. For example, development agencies representative isn't here. Now, looking at the grants given in Turkey, even it's possible to give a thesis, which institution is giving which grant. We have no problem with funding. As Meltem stated, it's all about flexible working, working without excuses. Once we did this, we'll have so many resources. There are international resources as well. You can apply directly to Brussels, €1 million worth of innovation projects and innovation projects, partnership projects, experience sharing projects. There are so many mechanisms. But specific to the universities, as an administrator, that's what I'm doing. I mean, it is not like, for example, being a lecturer only at the university. We have to be on the field, and we have to make, at the same time, their budgets more feasible. So I guess that's the way also to open up the path for them. I don't know, maybe it's also important to change the criteria for project selection, R&D, and all. Again, we're only focusing on publications, the theses on the shelves, the papers on the shelves that are not useful for academic career. Mainly in the energy companies also, we actually employ people with PhD. In all, for example, companies in Europe, they also have people working with PhD. Ferhat also mentioned in his presentation that in Turkish universities, we have one single type of PhD. For example, it's the PhD in technical and basic sciences, one single type of PhD that we have. And it's quite challenging. I mean, you have to take certain classes, and you actually have to successfully pass the exams. And would you please elaborate more on this, how we can have PhD together with the industry? I guess, first of all, the industry should ask for it. While I live in Denmark, Vestas, for example, in a forest field, try to use the turbines. And this actually results in some reduction in the performance. And it's not possible to find it out only with the engineers. So they, with some state support, they employ the PhD students. And they actually started a PhD program. 30% taking classes at university and 70% working at Vestas as a part of a project as a PhD student. And they go to the meetings all the time. And the scientific knowledge within the university is carried to the company. It's industrial PhD is the title, such a system. In Denmark, as much as I know, 10% of the PhD students take such a program. 90%, again, 100%, again, formal education. I think it will be useful for Turkey. Because especially one of the biggest fears in the company is mainly, for example, the energy spent, in particular for the PhD stops the work at the workplace. So especially for 2 or 3 years, what you do is, for example, you have a problem that you cannot overcome, you cannot fix. So you ask one of your employees to do a PhD and find a solution for your problem. That's a nice thing, I guess. And also, it's useful because we would like to have localization, which I believe is important. And if, for example, in a technology that we wish for, if we actually have to offer some new opportunities, then our team should work just at the R&D level.
then that's the only way that we can actually compete with the rest of the world, I guess. Thank you. Of course, it is innovation that we are always speaking about, and also local content. You know, you actually have to work hard in Turkey to do it at the locally. Maybe we start from scratch, but maybe the Europe actually can be more successful. But of course, from the perspective of renewables, local content is very important. Having local technology is important, and it's only possible, in particular, with You know, the private sector companies are having a lot of difficulty, not possible for them to have huge R&D teams, but the Turkish universities are ready. And, for example, from Turkish Scientific Council or from other places, we have so much funding, but Turkish people do not like to apply a lot to certain places. There is actually funding for this, but you actually have to have access. I don't know, maybe this is the most important thing for local technology, the university private sector cooperation. I'm sure that the academicians would also adjust themselves accordingly. Maybe it would be nice, for example, possible that major energy companies can actually start some initiatives at the techno parks. Maybe you know it, but in Turkey, basic science departments are closed down, physics, biology, and so. I mean, not possible to do anything about wind energy. I mean, physics is such a basic science that you cannot do without it in wind energy. We're just going through some hard times, but the education system also would be better. But especially if we would like to have more employment in energy, then we should be focusing on this. I mean, as you all know, we have more investments in wind energy. So therefore, employment is important. So last words for Melta. You are such a global company. How they recruit the high levels? Is it just headhunting that you do? How do you just recruit high levels in your company? I don't know. Maybe four of us would become candidates to become some senior executives in Vestas. Because that's also another branch of recruitment. Of course, in corporates in general, at that career path for senior executives, of course, you try to select people from the bottom, those that started early in the career path in the same corporate. As I told you, it's possible for you to select different career paths. So if you are supposed to become an executive, I don't know, maybe it could be a newly vacant position. So we have the recruitment first. First is announced. It could be from different channels. We are mostly using the ICT technology, and we are trying to have access to all channels that the candidates may have. We have interviews. And we have certain priorities for that, some assessment criteria, our values, whether our values are abided by, or, for example, depending on position, references are important, some psychometric analysis. For each position, we have it. But in very special positions, of course, again, we also take some help from outside. What about female employment? We don't have any such discrimination, I mean, that's cool. So it's employment only. So if you allow me, it is right on time that we finish. And that's the end of the session for training and employment. One very final word, if you allow me.
With regards to local technology, this discussed once again. For our country, it's very important to make local manufacturing and local technology. These are two different things. Local technology is important, university industrial cooperation, and also technology is important for this to be local. But what is important for our country in the energy is the local manufacturing. Vestas, for example, has just started with blade and new investment, which is something good. Therefore, the global companies are also important part of it. I think the energy, just like in the defense industry, should start speaking about offset.
Ben size vereceğim. Çok kolay bir şey.